This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we're talking to Peter Michael Slattery. There is a new documentary about him called Multidimensional, which only begins to describe my guest and all that he is and knows. Later in the show, I'm going to run for those who are watching on video, and there will be a link to this for those who are listening to the podcast audio on the Dreamland show page. He took a video, and I'm going to explain more about who Peter is in just a moment. He took a video on October the 2nd of an object, and he's got made lots of videos, and we're going to talk about that in just a minute. This object was extremely similar to the Brian Vike video that we have talked about on this show many times from 2002. And so for the viewers, I will show the videos side by side to give you an idea of the authenticity of what is happening with Peter. And I'm saying that because this has got to be one of the most remarkable life stories you're ever going to hear. If you want to learn more about it and more about his work, you should get the book CE5, Initiating Contact with Extraterrestrials, which is available on Amazon and I'm sure other places as well. Peter Maxwell Slattery, all I can say is welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you for having me, Whitley. It's great to talk with you.
Well, it's exciting to talk with you, too. Multidimensional is really not a strong enough word to explain you and what you do. That's only the surface of this remarkable life, which, by the way, folks, unlike a lot of other remarkable lives, my own included, this remarkable life is validated and supported by all kinds of UFO video. He takes a lot of video. He initiates contact for others with CE5 events. Let me start, Peter, by asking you when this started in your life.
All right, so it's great I'm talking to you, because if anyone's got weird stuff going on and will understand somewhat, it will be yourself. Because what I can say is that there was a few experiences before the age of seven that I don't talk about because it's very vague. But around the age of seven, I was foretelling things before they happened. I had what I could term as telepathic communication from a feminine energy that even my parents took me to a doctor and they're like, well, nothing's negative happening from this stuff. We can't explain it. And then between the ages of 8 and 12 is when it really got strange, because as weird as this is going to sound, I would wake up to Kurt Cobain in my room, the singer of Nirvana. Now, I don't talk about this in the documentary because I'm trying to keep it more mainstream, but there would be light in the room. Now, what happened was, over a series of experiences, I would see Kurt Cobain vibrate between what we could say is Kurt Cobain and a grey alien, but it was white. It wasn't your typical, meaning the grey coloured alien, though I have seen them. This entity had more of the horizontal black eyes, almond shape, and the skin texture, the only way I can describe it was like cigarette ash if you dabbed it with your finger, that sort of granule sort of texture. Over a series of encounters, there would sometimes be one, then there would be three, but that the image of Kurt Cobain would stop after a series of when these events started. And it was between 8 and 12 because I moved into a home at that time with my mother and stepfather. And then after that time, I moved to my father's house. So I used to wake up from this, I'd be scared. And I'd basically, what I can remember is pulling up the sheets every time, and there would be almost a feeling like your heart going down into your stomach. And I can remember light coming through the peripheral of the curtain. Now, whether the sun was up, whether it was a craft, whether there was another reason for it, I've got no idea. But that's specifically what I remember, and wishing that this entity would go away. At 12 years old was when I had my first, what we could say, UFO encounter. And this object, it was, I believe it was summer from the best time that I can nail it down. I was walking down a road called Dick Road to the Hume Freeway, which is the main highway between Melbourne and Sydney. And I lived in a town called Albury. And I was going down to a gas station. It was with one of those bottles I was going to get a slush puppy where if you fill it up, the bottle changes colour.
Right.
So I was walking down the road, which wasn't too far from the house to get to the gas station. And the only way I can describe it is this object. It wasn't a disc, meaning like the way they describe a disc, but it looked more like a weight pulled off the end of a weight bar turned horizontally. And it was a matte grey. And it floated in front of this hill called Red Light Hill until it went out of view. And the thing is with this object, it wasn't tiny. It was about three times the size of a football field. And to this day, I still wonder if anybody else saw it because there's no way people couldn't have seen it. And it just went to my left, which is to the west until it went out of view. So it's like I didn't even talk about it. I didn't tell anyone for a few years until I found out another family member had had their own sighting around the similar time. And what I could deem as high strangers started to become... pardon me, become a normal event for years after that. And then I'd have regular sightings every sort of, not regular, but they were every few years and there'd be people with me. But it wasn't until 2010 where not only did I start filming these objects on a regular basis up until today, but I'd have witnesses. I contacted the Australian Air Services, which told me nothing was in the air at the time of these sightings. And then I would start to have more interactions with what I could deem as blue orbs and other type of paranormal phenomena in the house until I started actually having what we could say is somewhat a dialogue with these entities somewhat shortly after that 2010 time period going into 2011, 2012. So that's like a brief thumbnail sketch just to sort of ram a lot into a short period speaking with you.
Now, there are others out there like Terry Lovelace and others that have pretty much continuous contact that's not entirely physical. Your case is rather remarkable in that you do have a lot of physical manifestations, including the blue orbs that show up in your house and the extraordinary UFO video that you've made. What is going on that would be different? Because Chris Bledsoe, for example, Terry Lovelace, and me, I mean, I'm in contact too with the visitors the same way you are and the same way they are up here mentally. But the difference between us is this. When they want to come in here physically, this place is filled with surveillance cameras, as you may imagine. The cameras are turned off by them. I don't turn them off. There's no way they don't turn themselves off, but they will turn them off. Or if the cameras are off and they're going to come in here physically, they will turn me off by causing me to have a period of missing time. I never see them. I never get any physical verification. And Terry and Chris are the same. They very little, but you get loads of it. We're so jealous. At least I am, but I'm kidding. I'm not jealous. What I'm asking here is, why is it this way? Do you think? What is your theory?
Well, to tell you the truth with this, I wouldn't even get 1% of what I see. So I have a very similar thing where I've just decked out this place that I'm in now. I've got a sanctuary on a few acreage. And I have the same stuff happen that cameras at times will be turned off. Other times I'll have missing time as well. So that's still, even recently with that recent video you spoke about, there was missing time before and afterwards. The only way I can describe it is that I keep a camera on me 24/7. And I think one of the things, whether I've had television crews with me or other people, it was almost a training to allow myself to center and film the activity. Sometimes I'm shaking when I'm filming, that people will see with crafts because of the energy and just the awe and sometimes nervousness. But what I can point back to is about 8-9 years ago, I had a well-known regression that was on YouTube with Mary Rodwell, where the only one, and I did it 3 times and I stopped because the entity started speaking through me and turning cameras on and off and the lights on and off, physical manifestations in the room with the people that were with me. And there was one bit in the first regression where they said, where basically words to the effect of, not exactly, but basically people will be capturing proof. Like, because I think with me, even though we could say a majority of the experiences are physical, I was very stubborn and still am sometimes very skeptical that there's so much stuff that I'm sitting on that I will not show publicly, because I can, in a way, you can always debunk something if you want to debunk it, but I was skeptical of the experiences where it's almost like I've had things reversed. Instead of going into physical contact, I started with physical contact but was still in disbelief, to where I had to go back, and that's where I trained in yoga and meditation and remote viewing and many other different disciplines to try and rise to the occasion to understand how and why does all this work, even though it was already working for me, meaning that I was already, what we could say, multidimensional mind in a way. So I can't answer that 100%, but it was something that was relayed from the beings through me that there would be more proof that Pete's just stubborn. And it was something that they kept true to their word, we could say, looking back pretty much after that onwards.
So the physical part of it, though, in your case, is enough to validate. I mean, that the video that you took at October the 2nd, which you didn't actually, when I first brought it up with you, you take so many videos, it took you a moment to remember which one it was.
Yeah.
But I would love to have taken a video like that. I have never been able to do that in my entire life. Now, but what is so interesting here and so important is the validation that's taking place. And I think that means that we should listen very carefully to what Peter Maxwell Slattery has to say, to in a sense, explain himself and how he understands who he is and who we are and where we are going. Now, I would like to move now to a thought that I had. You mentioned in an interview with Grant Cameron briefly a contact with someone from, you said, Orion, from the direction of Orion. That's happened. That's terribly important to me. The reason is I have had very few, but I have had a few experiences involving other worlds. And in one of them, the belt of Orion was present in the sky, and it was much larger. But there was another thing about that place that was quite extraordinary. Everything was conscious, even the plants, and you could feel it, that they weren't, I mean, I think plants here are conscious too, but they had very obvious presence. Everything did. This place was generally intelligent, let me put it that way. So let me ask you this. Do you think that different stars are at different stages of evolution, and that the planets that harbor life around them reflect the evolutionary level of the star? Does that make sense to you at all?
It does somewhat. The convoluted thing with this is the time aspect, what we perceive as time as well, because some of these beings are us coming back from what they've shown me, whether they are some of, and not, I'm not going to label this with the greys, but those some aspects of or some types that has been shown to me, even some of the humans. And so this is where it gets convoluted, that I think you're on the mark, but at the same time, if there's manipulation going on that is jump-starting a civilization further ahead of time, meaning in terms of the evolution of that type of entity, humanoid being, well, then that it could be fast-tracked. But if it was left in a natural progression, that might be the case as well. So the thing I like to say with this, which is it gets, and the word convoluted is really what it is everything as you know with yourself, not everything's black and white. The gray in the middle is usually where something is, and it's very vast. Especially when in recent contacts through visions and interactions, I've been shown that actually when we look at the physical universe the way that we perceive it, that the stars, they're actually part of a projection of what's creating this physical reality that we're experiencing. And so, and it's not putting the visitors down in terms of depending on where they are or what they are, because I believe we're all one consciousness interacting with itself. But it's my understanding over time through these experiences that the extraterrestrial component wouldn't even be 5% of what's out there. That once you get past a certain amount of, we could say, dimensions or densities, depending on how one wants to use the terms, once you get to a certain level of consciousness, there is a whole new ballpark of realms where there's no planets, there's no stars, and that's the other 90% to me from what I've experienced. And then when I hit what I call the geometric light realms, which is sort of like a living kaleidoscope effect with different forms of entities and intelligences in it, to when after that I hit sort of a void in my own experiences and I hit what we could say is, some might call it nirvana or a samadhi state, where you're one consciousness. But the problem is, from a human body standpoint, it can't sort of fully integrate and sort of comprehend. It's almost like we could say a computer from 20 years ago operating on today's software. It can't really do it. You get bits and pieces of it coming through. But this is sort of where the experiences have led me, in that some of these extraterrestrials that I'm interacting with, they're going through a process of evolution that they, we could say, going through their own ascension, that they may be, we could say, more enlightened or more evolved than us in some level, but they're still reaching to get to those higher existences and refine their own self-mastery journey. So this is where it gets very laid, that I started out thinking, all right, ETs, discarding a lot of stuff, what we could say, in ancient texts, whether it's biblical or what have you, but then I started having these experiences that I had no reference for, that was beyond what we could say a physical component on a planet or a ship. And it takes on a life of its own, where, like any good journalist or investigator, you'll let the evidence lead you where it may, and this is where it's led me so far through experiences and even recall.
Now, we're going to take a little break. We have a couple of soft breaks in the show. I don't think I mentioned that to you, Peter. One of Peter's books, the most recent one, is CE5, Initiating Contact with Extraterrestrials. We're going to talk to him in a little while about how that works and how he does it, because he does it. He's great friends with James Gilliland of the Isetti Ranch, who has been in the experience of close encounter and contact for many, many years. And so we'll be talking about that. The documentary about him that is, I found so amazing, which is why he is here on the show, is called Multidimensional. And there will be a link to it. And you should go there and actually do this. Many of us are very passive about our work in our lives. We just let things kind of roll. But this is a chance to open your mind in a completely new way, because we're talking to a man who has provable, extraordinary experiences, and that's rare in this world. His website is petermaxwellslattery.com. Yes, petermaxwellslattery.com. We'll be right back. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Peter Maxwell Slattery, the new documentary about him and his life, multidimensional. His website, petermaxwellslattery.com. Now, before we left the air briefly for our free Dreamlanders, I alluded to CE5, and you have quite a CE5 program. Could you tell us about when you first realized you could do this, that you could draw this to other people besides yourself?
So I use the term CE5. As we know, we could say Dr. Greer is the founder. There's others that James Gilliland's probably been doing this longer than anyone I personally know. And then I've even heard stories about Betty Hill. She used to go out with friends just sitting on chairs sort of with the intention. So I don't think this is anything new, though that's the term. And I prefer to call it initiating contact, but I sort of use CE5 as bait, but for those that are already in the community. It's something where it's more of an invitation, but over the years, what was confronting at the first was I just knew through what I call thought transfer when these beings are about. So even recently, with the recent craft sighting you spoke about, I had a period of missing time before it, and then I'm sitting outside on the deck and I just knew they were here. Walked out, I looked straight above the house and there it was. And most of the time, that's what it is. I'll say that they're here. I've had over 300 witnesses in my home experience this over many years and thousands around the world. And as you see in the video, there's groups in the park with me that are there with me. And I think these different forms of intelligences are everywhere. I don't even think it's hard to explain, but the way I explain it is imagine the universe is the internet and your soul is like what we could say is the software running the body computer. And so everything's interfacing with itself. And these intelligences, from my understanding, being at the level that they're at, depending on who and what it is, they're interfacing where they're picking up on the thought. Now, sometimes it will be something that's connected to me. Sometimes it will be something that's around, something that could even be living right next to us that we're not even seeing, that's picking up on that. But with this is where I say to people, before I was known for this, I was one of the people that you'd call to a haunted house that would go and investigate some of the most haunted places. And I've got a big understanding in the paranormal, meaning we could say ghosts, entities, poltergeist hauntings, high strangeness, residual intelligent hauntings, to where, as I said in the documentary, there's an overlay with this, because when you're doing something like this, you really have to be aware of your thoughts, because they will use your thoughts, whether it's positive or negative. So many people that have had a UFO encounter, I'll say to them, what happened before it? Just as an analogy, I'll say, did you have a thought or anything about, I've got to go and check on the mail outside or check if my car's locked? And then they go out and they look up and there's a craft there. They're using our thoughts to interface where, with myself, though it's evolved over the years, I'm getting visions, thoughts and feelings all in one go, and I'm projecting a thought back, and it's just almost like two souls merged or more, to where you've got a symbiotic relationship, sort of like the veils are gone, everything's known. So why I say this is because there are times that if people don't know what they're doing in terms of protection or shielding, there is negative entities that can come through. And it's hard enough when you wake up to this reality alone, how much your life changes. You don't want something sort of hijacking or coming in, but there is a purpose to what I deem as the lower light as well. So it is something through a technique where I try to get, I prefer small groups these days. Even at the sanctuary, I'll be opening up to sort of like 15 people at a time, which is still a bit big. But it's getting something like a symbiotic relationship, a group collective consciousness going on within that group, setting the intention. And I find that sometimes that's enough, that you don't need to meditate. Because so many times when we go to meditate, a physical manifestation will happen. And then we'll go, all right, let's go and meditate again. Then another physical manifestation happens. So it's really got to do with intention and the group being open to an experience. And there is a group, sort of some protocol somewhat that I teach people and show people, that when you're having the interaction or you're feeling the energy, how you can interface and acknowledge your thoughts through being the observer and not controlling, to where you can understand that they can use your thought pattern, but also you can push that thought back and interface or have a dialogue with this intelligence the best that you can from what I deem as the body computer. So there's quite a lot to it, but a lot of the time they'll even land on us like an apparition, like a ghost. They're phased out. And when they do that, the temperature changes and you can even walk to a certain extent where the temperature goes back normal and even the ambient environment in terms of audio, and you can go back in and it's slightly muffled, temperature's changed again, and in your peripheral you can even see the entities. To another point where they can even land a craft on you in your bed in an apparition form, phased out, but just you can slightly see them. A lot of the time when that happens to me, there is some type what of a hum or a vibration. And if I close my mind, I can see the beings on the craft. Sometimes my consciousness will sort of separate and I can go on board the craft. So talking to Native American elders and Aboriginal elders when I've spoke about this, they said that's how a lot of this happens. Sometimes you're not going anywhere. The overlapping, what we could say, is your space-time and then vibrating you into their space-time. And the physical body's not going anywhere. Sometimes it will. But what's happening is you're just changing frequency, and it's like changing a radio station. You're on, we could say, Earth, and then all of a sudden you're in a different reality, but right. You're still occupying the same space.
Now, free Dreamlanders, we're going to take another quick break because this is so fascinating, and I don't want to kind of break things up. So this will be the last break in the show, and we're going to go right on to the end of the first hour from here. So we'll be right back. This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010 talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I worked with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. We're talking to Peter Maxwell Slattery. The new documentary about him, multidimensional? Yes, multidimensional, which you can link to from Unknown Country, from the Dreamland show page. And I do hope that you spend the $10 or $12 it is necessary to spend to watch this and watch this documentary, because it is profoundly empowering to see and hear what is going on with Peter. it's very, it will, speaking of changing vibrations, watching it can change your vibration, I'm sure. I feel like it changed mine. And so do this. This is what it's all here for. That's why they're trying to communicate with us. Things like this documentary work. They're helpful. His website is petermaxwellslattery.com. And his most recent book, which we've been chatting about a bit, is CE5, Initiating Contact with Extraterrestrials. Now, Peter, when you, how often, let me ask you this, have you had physical face-to-face contact with the Greys? Because there's one clip in the documentary that kind of blew my mind. It's of a blurred image of a Grey standing beside a car. And I know certain things about the Greys that I don't speak about. And I'm not going to tell anyone why I know this is real. But I know the photograph really is of a Grey. And there have been a lot of fakes out there, God knows, but this isn't one of them. So how much physical contact have you had?
The Greys, it is something that, and again, there's different variations. There is the white type that I talk about, but there's smaller ones and taller ones of them.
Yes.
And then there's been a few different types of the actual Greys as well. It's not a common thing with them. It's something where it's like every few years and every now and then they'll pop in. So I do say that I have contact on a daily basis, predominantly through telepathy.
Same.
But it's, yeah. So, yeah. But I don't think a lot of the time it's with them. It's more with other beings that I have. Some I've had face-to-face interactions with. Some it will be astrally. We could say spirit guides. Sometimes it's other aspects of myself that coexist. That I know that's going to sound crazy to some people, probably not to your listeners, but some of these entities are other aspects of me. So even though we could say in the end everything's one consciousness, we could say directly sort of connected to my soul lineage, it's other aspects of me, though I think we're living all these lives at the same time. That's where I say we're not going to understand this if we look at things linear. We've got to look at 360-degree all possibility to understand any of this, because linear thinking is, it doesn't work with this because it really expands the mind. But the Greys are beings that, like I said, it's not a continual, it's a continuous thing over the years, but not a regular thing. It's like every few years, or it might be a few days within a week or a clump of months that there'll be something happen with them and then I won't see them for a while. So they're very sneaky in terms of my interactions, that like with the video where you can see it blinking. My family was saying, you've been talking about this for years, because what happened was I was in the house and my family was away at the time, and every time I went between the lounge room and the kitchen, I would see something in my peripheral around the hallway entrance, just like that. You know, it's like there's just something there that's darting behind the wall, and it looked like a shadow to me. I couldn't see anything, meaning physical. It just looked like there was a shadow, you know, in the peripheral just moving. So after a number of times walking from the lounge room to the kitchen there, I just grabbed one of the infrared cameras I have and just sat it on the dining room table, pointed, standing behind it while watching the television. I think I just had a documentary on at the time or something. And I saw it a couple of times, and then the camera turned itself off. Like you were saying, they'll do that. It turned itself off.
Right.
And when going to look at the footage, you know, I can't explain what I was feeling at the same time, because I'm like, part of me was like, damn, you know, this is like, it's sort of daunting, because the contact that I've been used to is not from them. Though part of it's like, finally. And that's what's most likely, I wouldn't say all the time, what's doing that. Because so many experiences have reported to me, they've had the same thing. There'll be something in the peripheral sort of, it's like something moving in and out, looking into the room and looking back, but nothing's there when they turn around or they walk around there. So the recent photo as well, that's probably what, 3-4 years after that encounter, that there was something walking on the roof of my cabin up near Mount Buffalo. And I know what a possum sounds like. This was something walking on the roof, and then all of a sudden something was on the ground outside the lounge room window. And when I went outside, I couldn't see anything. I think it was 3 photos. I didn't check it for like 15 minutes after I went in. I think I got a phone call or something happened. And when I looked at it, I sent it straight to Jason Gleaves, who's the image analysis on the documentary, ex-UK Air Force and Aerospace, and he's well known for image analysis.
Yes.
And that was what was in there, is what you see on that photo. But, you know, there's some things that happen in terms of when they're around. There's sometimes the electrical, you know, I've had the electrical box cut out. Sometimes
not
weird
exactly old. Unfamiliar. I mean, I'm sure a lot of the listeners are laughing because we all have this. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah. There's sometimes a static energy, but also it's like the atmosphere and the energy changes. To me, I describe it almost like my heart's being pulled down, like energy. I know it sounds weird, but that's sort of a feeling. Sometimes I get an effect too, and I can't describe it exactly, but it's almost like I have eczema borderline coming on, like an allergic reaction, to where I just sort of have this effect with my body. I can't describe it exactly, but it's like eczema, but I'm not getting the, you know, the flaky skin or the cracked skin, but it feels like that, especially around my eyes. I get that effect. There's probably other things that I'm missing too, but there is usually missing time with them. But also what I could say is, borderline this dimension and another dimension, that the experiences seem to bleed in between this reality and another at the same time. It's like there's an overlapping of worlds that happens. So this is where I've been confused in the past at times, but then when you photograph it and you capture it on cameras, on video as well, that shows that there is a physical component with these types of entities. And like I say, I can't just sort of ram it all into one area, because there's different types of what appears to be greys. As I said, some are white, some are gray. I've even seen some that are brown.
Yeah, I've seen brown, gray, and white also, all three colors. And they're actually not brown. They're sort of tannish. They're like almost the color of deer skin, at least the ones I saw.
Yeah, but and I have seen bluish yellow or blue and yellow ones as well that have that tinge of effect to them.
That I've not seen. Or glimpsed, I'm sure. We're both talking about glimpses, not long after. Yeah. Well, I wish they weren't so elusive. I ask them all the time, will you please just come in here and walk across the living room when the cameras are on one time? But it doesn't happen. Is it that it can't happen, do you think?
Like, the thing to me with this is that there seems to be some type of mandate on their side, that it's almost like the carrot's got to keep dangling to keep you on your path and have an urgency, but at the same time, we can't give you everything because we need it to, in somewhat way, be elusive for whatever reason. There's this elusive thing, and it's weird because when you're interfacing, we could say with the greys in particular, they read everything about you, and when you're looking into those dark eyes, you're looking into space. And
yeah,
there's and something where they know
your space.
They know every. This is what I say to people that is confronting when people are wanting disclosure. That can you deal with an entity that can look into your eyes and know everything that you've thought, would do, haven't done, your deepest secrets, your deepest thoughts. It's like everything at once, and not just with them, but even with what I could say the more humanoid energies and beings that I've interfaced with. But I think there's a part where I learned with them, they got nothing but, well, in terms of the humanoid energies and beings, they got nothing but love, compassion, and non-judgment. I wouldn't say all, because I don't know all agendas. I know that there is a dark side, because I have had interaction with reptilians and other types of entities. So with that said, there is different agendas out there. But the way I understand is that we've all left source, God, source, creator, whatever you want to term it, to experience and gain knowledge in every single different way possible. And there needs to be that dual aspect, which is the deeper aspects of that. But that's the thing I say to people, could you handle something that can look at you and know everything about you, and your mind's blown at the same time, because there's like this, you're trying to interact with them and it's almost like you only get what you get, where I can say over the years I've been able to get more information because, again, I've worked out instead of just being the observer, I can project, and they're somewhat able to articulate sometimes information back to me as well that I'm able to fathom. It's almost like they're flicking through my human brain, finding analogies and words to project back to give me concepts for whatever it is I'm either asking or trying to understand.
How close have you been to the craft themselves?
I've been in the crafts. So yeah.
Now, you have in your discussion with Grant Cameron, which, by the way, folks, is Grant's often on Dreamland, and it's a wonderful piece on YouTube that he and his research assistant did with Peter just recently, I believe, just this month. Is that correct?
Yeah. I think a week or so ago, yeah.
Yeah, a week or so ago, and it's a wonderful – you must watch it. I'll make sure that there's a link to it so that – because I'm not in the business of competing with my friends. I want to help them too. So in any case, in that conversation, you talked about different levels of being, and I interpreted that to mean that there are different levels of almost a physicality. Is that right, or am I going in the right direction here?
I think you are. Like, the way I could explain it is, even though to us it may be more ethereal or an energetic realm, when you're resonating with that plane of existence or realm, what dimension, density, whatever you want to call it, that's, I think, the way it becomes, like, because you're resonating with it, therefore it becomes physical.
Yes. In other words, we can, in effect, call this in and make it physical, can't we, to some extent?
I think, but it's meeting them halfway. And I, from what I know, is that, for example, with some beings, when they pop in, even though in my mind or I can be pulled astrally out and go somewhere else, when they're trying to break through to this realm, the most you might get is a flash of light. But what you'll feel, it's like when you feel energy or you feel like you're not alone, or a static sensation on the body or a temperature change, goosebumps, hair standing up. The way I explain this is that something's light body, even though we can't see it, is overlapping our light body. And that's a physical byproduct, that sensation on the physical body. And that's where sometimes I can close my eyes, even though you can't physically see them, but in my mind I can start seeing and interfacing with them. So this is where I say to people, there is sight, sound, touch, taste, smell in terms of the five sense reality, but there's also psychic ability, what I call thought transfer. There's also the mind's eye. And then there's also feelings and emotions that communication can be transferred through. So this is where it's a little bit, mainly when I'm interfacing in that way, I'm getting thoughts, feelings, and visions all in sync with, like, it could be just a, we could say terabytes of data just going, it's like bang, a hard drive's plugged into my mind. And just, you can't unravel a lot of it at the time. You get almost what I describe as chapter headings, and the paragraphs to each chapter that might filter through later, or when you sort of need to know, is sort of sitting in the light body, because it's like the information goes from the light body into the physical body. Like, if it's, it can be, we could say, transferred or integrated in that way. So it's something where it depends on the type of entity, the energy, where it's normally vibrating at in terms of where it's resonating with its field of plane of existence. Because what I know from experience is sometimes there's lower entities that will be sort of an intermediate between them that will do some of the physical stuff, where before they'll take the physical, my physical body, and then they'll separate my consciousness from my physical body, and then I could go to the higher realms, but I couldn't do it in the physical body. And that's because sometimes I needed a physical interaction for whatever reason.
Right.
And then I had to go up the chains and the planes and dimensions. And this is where, you know, talking to James Gilliland over the years about this, and then hearing about J.J. Hertak from the Keys of Enoch and some of the stuff that he's wrote, I'm like, this is pretty much the same stuff that's going on with me, but I didn't understand some of it until I sort of heard it articulated in certain ways, because there's sort of no reference to this. And when you're not sort of like, you're sort of weaning it to learn this your own, even though you're interacting, it's not like these interactions every time of them having a dialogue like this, though. It's got more like this over the years, where it's sort of like, all right, why are you here? What's going on? Sometimes you just get nothing out of that. It's just something's going on that you can't integrate. So it's very layered in terms of that with the phenomena, what can manifest and what can't, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think that to a degree, perhaps there isn't enough energy to manifest in this level. You've mentioned for example, entities that will make an effort to manifest, and it's just not, it's just a flash of light. And so it could be that that's the case. Now, we've had at our cabin, there was a little UFO that would show up from time to time and take people on rides, quite frankly. I mean, it was back in the late 80s and early 90s when this was happening. It had to have been the best theme park in the world, this little cabin, because you could go in and, you know, I see Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos so excited about going up into space in rockets. And I remember when we used to go up in this thing, it would just take a second and you were outside the atmosphere. When you walked up to it, first it was very small. It seemed smaller than you could possibly fit in, but there was plenty of room inside anyway. And it felt like a living being. It was like walking up to a person. Can you, and I know that you respond to that, can you explain to us or describe your own experiences with that?
So when we talk about it, I say it's like a car. What type of car have you been in? There's different types, and it's going to sound strange to some people. There has been your typical flying saucer type. The way I can describe it is that the material is like a matte gray, but it's like Terminator. Remember Terminator 2 with the liquid sort of Terminator that can reshape form and shapeshift? It, inside the craft was like that, to where there was seats on it, but they were very plain. There was these ridges where you could put your hands, and this was the way that they could operate the craft. But what was weird with this as well was, yes, the craft was living and you could become symbiotic with it, but there would even be projections of stuff that was shown to me out of the peripheral of the saucer that would project down, like almost holographic information. The entire craft can go transparent in this particular one, to where it's like you can see it's like the whole thing turns into glass, is the way that I can describe it. There is a common theme with the type of smell on some of these crafts, and even this one, to where the way I describe it is, it smells like first aid alcohol, but there's something else with it that I can't, it's almost like a flower or a plantish sort of tinge to it. I can't explain it, but there's these smells, and sometimes the atmospheres are different. Sometimes it's heavier. Sometimes it's almost like electrified, like before what you could say like a storm, an electric storm, like a lightning storm. But even when it's cooler, there's somewhat sort of like a pressure within the crafts. Now, in other crafts, the walls are structured from light.
Yeah, this is fascinating. Go ahead.
Yeah, so there's multiple experiences with being on crafts that are structured from light. There's still some definition, which is hard to explain, because even in the saucer as well as in the crafts where the walls are structured from light, the floor, the ceiling, you can still see a curvature where you would think there would be corners. But they can also, through connecting with the craft, create rooms or shape-shift the room as well. And it is a similar thing like you're saying. I've been in crafts that look like they're the size of, let's say, about two sizes of a family van that you'd fit, seven to nine people in, something like that. It's double the size, but you get in the thing, and it's the size of a house.
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
Yeah. So there is that component. I've been on ones with purple walls, like a mother of pearl effect as well, and also to where it looks like you're in a white room, like you see in a movie, where it would of course be a green screen, but when you're filming it and they edit how everything's white, that's what I've been in one particular craft as well. Sometimes I can't see. There's one being that looked like E.T. from the movie E.T., and all I could see on that craft was, I don't know how the light came, but it literally looked like it had a torchy, like in a horror movie, because it's got a sense of humor. And there was smaller brown greys around him. And it's the funniest being I've ever met. It's just got a sense of humor and a half. And you're like, you don't know if this is just how the being is or if it's operating that way, just to try and just let you know that everything's okay. But it's got a sense of humor. But the crafts are all different, where there's no panels, though there has been one craft where I've sort of seen stuff on a peripheral, but it's nothing that we would describe as like a normal type of panel. But it's something where it's almost like your light body is overlapping the light body of the craft, because remember, it's a form of intelligence. Yes, some can be grown in space the way that I understand. Yes, some have a structure where I've even got material, which is alluded to in the documentary, that what they told me is that a material like pyrite can be broken down and put out throughout the molecular structure of a craft to give it a symbiotic relationship with the pilot. I'm not sure how this is done, but that's more of what we could say us in the future, where I've got that material, which is a being from the Pleiades that, from what they've told me, they're us in the future that came back. So they've alluded to certain low-level technology that would still seem exotic to us today. But even with the Pleiadian crafts, they've got ball-shaped crafts, they've got flying saucers, but the metal balls they also live in. When I've been there, it looks like you're in Washington State. They don't have to put any infrastructure in. They don't have to put roads in. There's none of that. They live in these balls and they can pick up and go where they want. They're about the size of a house to a two-story house. And then I've seen other ones where literally these, what I could say is more evolved, ascended versions of those same beings, I've seen them go like this and create an egg-shaped craft through consciousness that has a rainbow iridescent hue on it. And they step into it. And the thing that I'm wondering about is, if you can be in your light body and you can travel anywhere to where you don't need a craft, well, why create something like this? And the only way I can understand it is it's something to protect them, almost like a buffer from outside vibrations. Or that's, yeah, the only way I can describe it, to protect them from outside vibrations. So when we're talking about this, there's a lot that I don't talk about to sort of hear about from other experiences, to see where things go, like yourself with the greys. And I'm sure there's so much we both could go on about that stuff as well. But it is one of those things where most of these entities now that I'm interacting with, they don't have a craft. And when they do, they're a less evolved form, though they may be pretty evolved. But one of the most amazing experiences in my early days was I appeared on a craft, broad daylight, over my home. It was made out of what I could call is liquid bluish light, like a more of a baby blue. And if I focused on the bottom of the craft, I could see it. But if I almost looked at it like one of those third eye, or those puzzles where you cross your eyes and it comes three-dimensionally, I could see my house through it in broad daylight, real time. And this was where it started getting confusing to me, because I was one of these blue light beings and I was sitting with another six of them in a meditative type pose within this craft that was a disc sort of shape but structured from light. And that was probably what I could say in recall in this life, where I had a symbiotic relationship with every entity on that craft and they knew everything about me, and a lot was revealed to me from that, even going in the past lives at a future date from there. And that's where I started to sort of like need a break for a while, because I'm like, this isn't nuts and bolts or little green men like people want to say from somewhere else. What the hell is this type of experience? Because it was mind-altering. And as I've spoken about, these beings have been revealed to me as the Elohim. So, and I don't want to get biblical or religious, cultish, anything like that, but that's the way that they've revealed themselves to me.
You know, my listeners know this, and I won't go into it in any detail. My uncle Mickey and his friend Arthur Exon were in the Air Force when the Roswell incident occurred, and they were actually at Wright Field when the debris and bodies were brought there. And they handled the physical debris and the physical bodies. At least my uncle never said anything about the bodies, but General Exon did. And he actually held them, one of them, in his arms. And so there is a physical component to this. And in fact, I've got in this office a fragment of material that's unexplainable, that came from given to me by Art Bell, and Linda Moulton Howe's fragment of the same material has been under study at the I believe by the U.S. Army, and this is very definitely not anything we could create, and it's all physical. So there is a physical component here. There's no question of that. Not as evolved as you'd said so correctly, I think. But can you talk a little bit about the meaning of this physical component? Go ahead.
Yeah, so like there is even crystal, like I've seen crystals in the middle of the craft. Like I've seen stuff that looks like similar to what Bob Lazar describes, but not the same. Like I've even seen one version where there was a crystal where he says the waveguide is going from the reactor up. I've seen a crystal that was a consciousness inside a glass cell, like a cellular cylinder tube in these types of crafts. And the I've got different materials here that when people hold them, there's a vibration and people just, especially it appears to be metallic, but I think some of these crafts aren't even metal. I think they're a type of what appear to be metal, but they're a type of crystal, or they've been manufactured with parts of metal and parts of crystal combined.
You know, that's a very interesting thing because a Dr. Robert Sauerbacher, who was a metallurgist who worked on this material, told me that it was welded at the molecular level and it was in had a crystalline structure to the welds. In other words, it was metal, but the strength of it came from the fact that they had rearranged the molecules into forms like crystals.
Well,
so you're quite right, I think.
And another craft that I forgot to mention, I write about this in a book 8-9 years ago called Operation Starseed, to where it's I don't know what it's made out of, but to me it looks like quartz crystal. You're in a quartz crystal cave and the whole thing is pulsating. Wherever you look, there's a light within the crystal that's pulsating.
That's just like, so, it's like a living thing.
Well, yeah, 100%. 100%. Yeah. So this is where I think it depends on the level of consciousness, but this shows that there are physical entities that we could say time and space is not a problem for them and traveling with it, doing what they may. Then we've got a component where some of these crafts are structured from light, some are structured from crystal, and then some of these crafts, they're beings in their light body, whether you want to say rainbow light body, their ascension body, their pure essence, which I believe we all have. They've evolved to that state of consciousness to where they've we could say, transcended the physical form, and they've become somewhat masters in their own right, to where space and time and is nothing to them, and they don't need a physical device. One experience that I was shown, the best way I can describe it, that the information was articulated to me, was that some of these beings can break down to a single electron, and because all electrons have a symbiotic relationship, through consciousness they can pop out at another one and rebuild there, and then some are operating purely through the photon. And this is where, with these crafts, the way it's been explained to me, was that some of them will get to a certain point where they break into photon light, and that's how they travel in that state and then rematerialize again. And I've seen different types of propulsion on them as well. One of them had these two massive donut rings that were going separate ways, but you could see through the wall and see them on the peripheral of the saucer. So, like, that's where it's an ever-learning thing for me, like you, Whitley. I think the more I learn, the more I wonder about. But the funny thing is, I know that we know it all here.
I think right we do. Here. I think we all know exactly what's going on. And there's a level of us that's vibrating so fast that it doesn't reach into the physical. And it's trying to. And that's what all these contact experiences are probably about. But I want to just go briefly back to this business of transforming into light in order to move through the universe. In my book, The Grays, I describe that because I was told about it and I couldn't tell you who told me or anything, but I think that's exactly right. But I don't think that they travel at the speed of light because they couldn't. That's too slow. It's much too slow. So how do they travel?
Well, that's where it depends on the navigation system, what they're using. This is where the crafts, as they have a consciousness, it's like there's a mapping within they're able to connect to what I say is like a universal mind or a mapping system that even knowing people within certain projects, we could call a star system by a certain name, but they're all giving it sort of like a, it's like part of an algorithm. And so when you're dealing with these advanced beings that are operating their light body, I think this is child's play for them. But how it works with the navigation systems of what we could say less advanced civilizations, I think it's something beyond what we are even starting to comprehend now with quantum computing, to where it's beyond mapping, but it's more energetic signatures that things are picked up from the star systems and what's around those stars, to where these things can navigate, because it's not like getting a map out and go, I'm going to go here, though they can project things like that. I think it's far beyond a way that I can even explain, because like they've shown me, it's like they'll break into light and then travel to where they've got to go. But you think about how vast even this galaxy is to try and map that. What, they say 300 to 400 billion stars? I think something like that, don't quote me. That's a lot of bloody mapping to do, let alone if you're going into another galaxy. Well, you know what I mean?
No, there are more galaxies in the universe than there are stars in our galaxy.
Exactly.
You know what one of the rarest things in the universe actually is? Any grain of sand on planet Earth. That's how many stars there are. That compared to the number of stars, the number of grains of sand on Earth are very, very tiny numbers. They're minuscule. And the number of human beings, we think, oh, there's so many people here. But we are actually so rare that we would be, in a statistical analysis of the universes, of the contents of the universe, we would be an undetectably small number. So there we are. Listen, we're coming to the end of the first hour, and in the next half hour, we're going to look at some of the video, but we're going to also talk about something that has fascinated me. Peter has quite a good relationship with Mary Rodwell. We're going to talk a little bit about Mary's work, even though I'm sure her ears will be burning. What Peter has learned from his work with Mary, because this figures very prominently in the documentary Multidimensional. We're going to talk about his discovery of what was going on in his missing time experiences, which were uncovered in sessions with Mary. And I'm very interested in that because I've had these experiences very recently, and I would love to know what was going on in them as well. His most recent book is CE5. There are others, Awakening, UFOs, and Other Strange Happenings. Please go to the website, to unknowncountry.com, and click through to the documentary and watch it, because it is going to be exactly the same thing for you as it was for me, a very empowering experience, because it's not often that you see someone talking like Peter talks about these experiences and having confirming video. It's just a remarkable life, Peter. And I'm so glad you're here with us, both on Dreamland and in this world generally, because all of us can raise our vibrations by knowing what's happening with you. So thank you.
No, thank you to you as well. In the years and years, I know you've gone through a lot of blacklisting and others. Think you've gone through a lot, and I've gone through a little bit of that myself. So thank you for sticking it out all those years, because, you're teaching a lot of people and helping them help themselves. So thank you for what you've done as well and doing.
Thanks. Well, yeah, I've been canceled a few times. I'm sure you have been too.
Yeah,
I was canceled long before they had the idea of canceling. But in any case, yeah, thanks. Free Dreamlanders, join us on unknowncountry.com. We'll see you next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.